And so here we go. We're going to actually read 1 Samuel 6, and then we're going to go and read 2 Samuel 6. And like I've said in the past, I'm not going to apologize for reading a lot of Scripture, because the Apostle Paul told young Timothy, pay close attention to the reading of public Scripture. Pay close attention to the doctrine, for by doing so you will save both yourself and your hearers. Amen. So it's good for us to read the Scripture in public. You know, during the time frame of Nehemiah and Ezra, when they found the book of the law, they read to the children of God out in public, and the people stood for 8 hours listening to the reading of the word and began to weep, amen, from the bottom of their hearts, because they had been separated from the word of God and the presence of God for so long, and to have it restored unto their lives really touched them and did a powerful work in them. All right. So basically the story, essentially, to give you an idea of what's going on here, we're starting off in 1 Samuel whenever God gave Israel a king. They cried out for a king, and he gave them Saul. And under Saul's leadership, the Ark of the Covenant was lost. Then when we turn to 2 Samuel chapter 6, David is now king, and he's going back to fetch the Ark, okay? And so everything in this narrative that we're going to read surrounds the Ark of the Covenant. It says in 1 Samuel chapter 6, and the ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. So they had already lost the ark at this point. Basically what happened was is that Israel went up to fight against the Philistines. And they said, go fetch the ark. They brought the Ark of the Covenant with them. And what we need to understand, and most people that have been coming to this church for a while, we've taught on this extensively, and you understand, the Ark of the Covenant represents literally the presence of God. Yes. The presence of God dwelling with His people. We understand that because God told Moses in Exodus chapter 25, He said, build me a sanctuary or a tent so that my presence might dwell with my people. And then even more specifically, He stated that the place His presence was going to dwell with His people was between the cherubim, which was two angels that faced one another, had their wings pointed towards one another, and had their heads down towards the covering on top of the Ark of the Covenant. Inside the Ark of the Covenant was the Ten Commandments. But the point is that God said between the cherubim, between those two angels that sit upon the mercy seat, my presence will dwell with my people. And the reason that God's presence, I'm just explaining it to you, was able to dwell with His people is that once a year on a day called the Day of Atonement, the high priest, who was the only one that had access into the Holy of Holies, which was beyond the veil, would take blood and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat. And so now these cherubim, which is another name for a specific type of angel that was actually Lucifer before his fall. He was a cherub. He was the anointed cherub according to the book of Ezekiel. And they protected, if you will, it seems as though, the presence of God. But what ended up happening is that once a year the high priest would go beyond the veil, taking blood and sprinkling the blood upon the mercy seat 7 times. And now the cherubim who are facing the mercy seat and peering down into, once again, you got to remember what was in there. It was the law, the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments were broken. Why? Because man can't keep God's law. You can't keep God's law in your heart, in and of your own self, and in and of your own strength. And ultimately, God had given Israel the law to prove to them that ultimately they needed Jesus. Amen. But once a year, the Holy Spirit would go beyond the veil into the Holy of Holies, and He would sprinkle blood upon that mercy seat, changing it from a place of judgment, where now they're no longer peering down into the broken law, but instead they're now looking upon the blood of an innocent sacrifice whose blood has been shed, and now it's turned into a place of mercy. Amen. Now, I don't mean to get too technical, but the Apostle Paul says in the book of Romans chapter 3 that Jesus is our propitiation. The word propitiation in the Greek language is actually the same word that's used for mercy seat. So essentially what Paul was saying right there is Jesus is our mercy seat. Does that make sense? Yes. See, because you were born of Adam, born in sin, and the law was broken because of your sin. It wasn't just Adam that broke it, but each and every one of us, if you could use a card playing term, has thrown in their ante into the pot. Each and every one of us has sinned against God, but God tells us, Paul tells us that Jesus is our mercy seat, amen. He shed His blood, and now the law that was against us, amen, He's our go-between, and He's provided reconciliation. And so I just wanted to give you a little bit of a history about the Ark of the Covenant, and really what it represents the presence of God in Israel. Once again, before this story right here, here was getting ready to go to war against God's enemy, and he said, hey, go fetch the ark. But things weren't right with Israel at the time, and they ended up losing the Ark of the Covenant. And what ended up happening was that the Philistines thought that they had brought a great victory on that day. And what they did was they took the Ark of the Covenant, they stuck it in the temple with their god, which is known as Dagon. And lo and behold, now I'm kind of shooting from the hip because I didn't go back and read that far, but from what I remember, they woke up the next morning and Dagon had fallen down on the ground. And if I'm not mistaken, what they did was they picked him back up. They went back in the next day. I think he had fallen down again, and maybe his head was broken off or something broke. And all of a sudden they realized this wasn't such a great idea to begin with. After all, we thought that we had defeated the God of Israel, but the reality of it is that his God is a whole lot greater than our God. We need to let God know we're sorry. Amen. And we need to get this Ark of the Covenant out of our possession and get it back to his people. Amen. And so that's where we are in chapter 6 of 1 Samuel. And the Ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. And the Philistines called for the priests and the diviners, saying, what shall we do to the Ark of the Lord? Tell us wherewith we shall send it to his place. And they said, if you send away the Ark of the God of Israel, send it not empty, but in any wise return him a trespass offering. In other words, you've sinned against him, you need to give him an offering if you're going to recognize that he, because basically what happened was he put some plagues hit him. And not only did their God fall down, but they got plagued with tumors. Now the King James translates it as emrods. Some people have thought that they were hemorrhoids. I'm just being honest. But the reality of it is that nobody really knows for sure. The trespass offering that they offer up was actually 5 mice and 5 golden tumors, or emrods, like the King James Version calls it. Some people believe, there's no way to prove it, that God could have stricken them with a bubonic plague type thing that caused the rats. And with the rats comes the bubonic plague, which causes some kind of a boil or tumor in the body. But nevertheless, there were 5 Philistine lords, and they gave them 5 golden tumors and 5 mice, and they put it with the ark to send it back over there. All right, so that's what it says. And they said in verse 3, and if you send away the ark of the God of Israel, send it not empty, but anywise return him a trespass offering, then you shall be healed, and it shall be known to you why his hand is not removed from you. Then said they, what shall be the trespass offering which we shall return to him? They answered, 5 golden emrods and 5 golden mice, according to the number of the lords of the Philistines. For one plague was on you all and on your lords. Wherefore you shall make images of your emrods and images of your mice that mar the land, and you shall give glory unto the God of Israel. Peradventure he will lighten his hand from off you, and from off your gods, and from off your land. Wherefore then do you harden your hearts as the Egyptians and Pharaoh hardened their hearts? When he had wrought wonderfully among them, did they not let the people go? And they departed. You remember that story, right? God said, let my people go so that they might worship me. And Pharaoh hardened and stiffened his neck and hardened his heart. But God had a way as he kept sending those plagues on. And finally he said, I got to let him go. But then even then, he still hardened his heart. Well, this is a priest of the Philistines. Now, you got to understand something. These people are worshiping false gods. This is occultic worship. The fish god Dagon. And he's got enough sense to know something. Did we learn anything that happened to the Egyptians? You need to let this situation go. It says in verse 7, now therefore make a new cart. Take 2 milk kine. What does that mean? 2 milk cows. On which there has come no yoke. And the kine to the cart, and bring their calves home from them. And take the ark of the Lord, and lay it upon the cart, and put the jewels of gold which you return him for a trespass offering, and a coffer by the side thereof, and send it away that it may go. And see if it goeth up by the way of his own coast to Beth Shemesh, then he hath done us this great evil. But if not, then we shall know that it is not his hand that smote us. It was a chance that happened to us. So in other words, they're saying, go ahead and hook these milk cows up to this cart. Put the ark on there. Let them go. And if they happen to show up to Beth Shemesh on their own, then we know it was God's hand that did all of this. If not, it was just coincidence, and we don't even need to worry about their God anymore. We don't need to be scared. All right. So verse 10, and the men did so and took 2 milk cows and tied them to the cart and shut up their calves at home. And they laid the ark of the Lord upon the cart and the coffer with the mice of gold and the images of their emrods. And the kine took the straight way to the way of Beth Shemesh and went along the highway, lowing as they went. and turned not aside to the right hand or to the left, and the lords of the Philistines went after them unto the border of Beth-Shemesh. And they of Beth-Shemesh were reaping their wheat harvest in the valley, and they lifted up their eyes and saw the ark and rejoiced to see it. And the cart came into the field of Joshua, a Beth-Shemite, and stood there, where there was a great stone, and they clave the wood of the cart, and offered the kine or the cows a burnt offering unto the Lord. And the Levites took down the ark of the Lord, and the coffer that was with it, wherein the jewels of gold were, and put them on the great stone, and the men of Beth-Shemesh offered burnt offerings and sacrificed sacrifices the same day unto the Lord. And when the five lords of the Philistines had seen it, they returned to Ekron the same day. And these are the golden emerods which the Philistines returned for a trespass offering unto the Lord, for Ashdod one, for Gaza one, for Ashkelon one, for Gath one, for Ekron one. These are all five provinces that were of the people of Philistines. You might recognize Gath, that's where Goliath was from. He was a Philistine. Five lords, five provinces, and it's just explaining that that's where these lords had ruled over. Verse 18, and the golden mice, according to the number of all the cities of the Philistines belonging to the five lords, both of fenced cities and of country villages, even unto the great stone of Abel, whereon they set down the ark of the Lord, which stone remaineth unto this day, in the field of Joshua the Beth-Shemite. And he smote the men of Beth-Shemesh, because they had looked into the ark of the Lord, even he smote of the people 50,000 and threescore, which means threescore is actually 60, so 50,000 and 60 and 10, so 50,000 and 70 men. And the people lamented because the Lord had smitten many of the people with a great slaughter. And the men of Beth-Shemesh said, who is able to stand before this holy Lord God? And to whom shall he go up from us? And they sent messengers to the inhabitants of Kirjath-Jearim, saying, the Philistines have brought again the ark of the Lord. Come ye down and fetch it up to you. All right, let's turn to 2 Samuel chapter 6. So, the ark of the Lord stayed at a man named Abinadab's house for 20 years. The whole time that Saul was, for a period of time that Saul was king, the ark of the Lord was not with Israel. For the first 7 years of David's reign, he reigned from a place called Hebron. And then after that, he moved the capital to Jerusalem. And many of you will remember that we've talked about this before, but the name Jerusalem, does anybody know what it means? Jerusalem? That's right. The name Jerusalem, Salem, Shalom, peace. It means peace. And so it's known as the city of peace. And I certainly preached on this particular passage of Scripture out of 2 Samuel before, 2 Samuel 6, but today's message is definitely a little bit different. All right, 2 Samuel 6, verse 1. Again, David, now he's the king, and David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, that dwelleth between the cherubims. And they set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah. Now, I'll be honest with you, it's the first time I ever really made the really close connection that essentially David's trying to bring transport the ark exactly the way the Philistines did. He's trying to put it on a cart, and he's following the lead of the heathen. He's following the lead of the world. And David, in reality, is the man of God. Amen? And so the truth is that we need to understand that sometimes folks in the church, and even sometimes leaders in the church, when none of us are excluded, can get in the flesh and make decisions that are contrary to the ways of God. And we find ourselves walking in a pathway that's contrary to the will of God. And we don't understand why things aren't going the way that we want them to go. And so it says right here in verse 3, and set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah. And Uzzah, the sons of Abinadab drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments, made of fir wood, even on harps, and on psalteries, and on timbrels, and on cornets, and on cymbals. And now you see the picture that's going on here, right? I mean, we've heard the story before. We've heard many preachers preach it before, how David is dancing before the Lord. There's music that's being played, and there's a great worship that's going on, and the excitement surrounds the fact that God's presence is coming back home. Amen. Yes. Coming back to the place that David has really gone ahead and he's prepared a place for. David is a man that does love the Lord and he cares about the presence of God. And as we see when the story's over, he's actually made a tent for it. He's made a tent, a special place for the presence of God to be able to dwell. Yes. And he's going to go fetch this ark. And it says, verse 6, and when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. I don't know, maybe the wheel fell into a pothole or something happened and the cart shook and the ark kind of vibrated a little bit. And Uzzah, I guess he kind of freaked out a little bit. I'm going to steady the presence of God. And he put his hand on it to try to keep it in place. Verse 8, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. Now, I looked up that word breach, and it essentially means it's a breach, it's a break. It's kind of like if you had a military surrounding you, and all of a sudden an enemy came through and broke a hole and came in and brought destruction. That's how David viewed this. The Lord made a breach. He just came in and he ambushed us. You know, why would God do this? We're his people, and we're trying to, and David was upset with it. And David, and it says right here, David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. It means a breach on Uzzah. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how shall the ark of the Lord come to me? How am I going to get the presence of God back? So David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David, but David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, saying, the Lord hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because of the ark of God. So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bear the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod. Now, every time I preach this message, I usually stop right here and I try to make a point. And the reason that I do this is because I kind of grew up in churches that taught things a little bit differently than the way I understand the gospel nowadays. And the way that I always heard this message preached was that the reason that the presence of God was coming back home was because the people of God were worshiping the Lord. So once again, you got to remember, in the first scenario, they're playing music, they're excited, the presence of God's coming home, amen? In the second scenario, again, music, David's dancing before the Lord. It even talks about the fact that he was dancing in a linen ephod. It means he took out his outer garment, amen, and he began to dance and he was twirling. Yes. You've seen movies before where they show David dancing with all of his might and all of his heart. So much so, we're not going to read that part in the story, that when they come into the city of Jerusalem, Saul's wife, who was married to David, her name was Michal. I looked up the word. It's not something that sounds more feminine like Michal or whatever. No, it's Michal. That's what it is. And she looked upon David and she said, you know, she basically gave him a hard time, saying that he had lowered himself in front of the people and that essentially she was embarrassed of him. She was embarrassed of him because of the way that he was all out worshiping the Lord. He told her, he said, I'm about to get more undignified than this, because he said, I'm going to worship the Lord. But one of the main points I wanted to make to you was this. It wasn't because he was worshiping the Lord, and it wasn't because they were playing music that the presence of the Lord was coming on. You gotta understand that. Because many times people think, oh, I'm going to get my worship on, and I'm going to seek the God of glory. Don't get me wrong. The scripture says that if you draw near him, he will draw near you. I'm not trying to say that we're not supposed to seek the presence of God. God has one prescribed order for you and I to be able to connect to His presence. And my entirety of my message this morning is really about that. And God's prescribed order has to do with the shedding of blood to pay for the penalty of sin. Just as the blood had to be sprinkled upon the mercy seat to change it from a place of judgment to mercy, this Ark of the Covenant, you missed it if you didn't see it, is not coming home to Jerusalem except that every six paces, you saw what it said, every six paces an animal will sacrifice. I remember, I keep saying it every time I preach it because I don't want to steal it, but Ross preached that message for us and he said, look behind you and look at the trail of blood that is left behind because of the sacrifices that are offered every six paces. And you won't make me, you'll never convince me that the number six was put there accidentally. No, the number six is the sixth day, when the sixth day was when man was created, and man born of Adam is born in sin, and therefore he required redemption and the shedding of blood. And every sixth pace is reminding mankind that he's sinful, but that God has a prescription. An animal had to be sacrificed, his blood shed for the life of the creature is in the blood. God said in the book of Leviticus, so I've given it to you to make atonement for the soul. The reason you and I can worship the Lord, the reason you and I can draw near unto God and He will reciprocate and draw near unto us, is because He sent His only begotten Son, the sinless one, to die on the cross in payment for the penalty of our sin. Amen. And when we take our faith, our free will faith that He gave us, He's not making you do anything. He's not going to twist your arm. Yes. He's not going to twist the preacher's arm and say, oh no, you're going to put your faith in what I provided. He's not going to do that. But when you and I take our free will and say, yes, God, I see this is your plan. This is the way you chose to restore humanity back unto you. And so I will put my faith in what you've done, recognizing that without this sacrifice, recognizing that without your intervention, I am altogether undone. I was born of Adam and full of sin and unworthy to enter into your presence, but you made a way. If you can't come to that conclusion, Christian, you got a problem. I can't call you Christian. Because until you come to the place, listen to me, the true word of God and the true church is not just about numbers and about people being all excited and happy. No, it's coming to the realization that I serve a God that is holy and He has a plan. Amen. And it requires you and I to be able to line up with that. And as long as we think there's something good in us, other than Jesus. Yeah, there's a champion in you, all right. Oh, yeah. If you're a Christian, His name is Jesus. Amen. 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 It ain't something, it ain't your own spirit. There ain't no champion of your own spirit. It's Jesus. Amen. He's the champion. Yes. Amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. And so that's what they did. It said right here that, let's see here, verse 13. Let's go to 14, I'm sorry.
15.
All right, 15. Thank you. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. You ever see people worship the Lord and kind of despise them? I used to watch my brother-in-law back when I was really bound up with sin, and I'd just go to church because that's what I thought I was supposed to, Aaron. And my brother-in-law Aaron, you know, that was back when he had some serious joy up in his heart, right? He'd be jumping up, he's about 6'5", and he'd be leaping, whew, and almost his hands touching the ceiling over there, cornerstone. And I was thinking in the back, man, look at this, bro. What's this all about? I just had something wrong in my heart.
Yeah.
My heart was all wrong. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And listen to me, if you watch other people worship the Lord and that's how you feel about them and you laugh, and you got something wrong in your heart, buddy.
Amen.
And you better do business with God. You better ask Him to do a work on the inside of you. Because if somebody wants to jump and shout and scream for Jesus because God's gotten a hold of them and set them free for something, you may end up being like Michael when it's all said and done. The Bible says at the end that she was barren from that day forward. She never bore fruit. She never had a child in her womb. That's what it means in the physical. But you won't convince me that it doesn't mean that spiritually that she never bore fruit for God because she judged King David and his desire to worship the Lord. You better not judge people whenever they're worshiping the Lord and they're trying the best way they know how to give everything that they have unto God. Listen to me. Their personality may be different than yours. Their worship might look different than yours. You might be more quiet and reserved, but if somebody else is being vocal and giving their worship and their love unto Jesus, you better learn how to respect that and appreciate it.
Amen.
If it gets too out of hand, don't worry, the preacher will talk to him. But other than that, amen, let's let people worship the Lord. All right.
Amen.
And this is the main part I really wanted you to see. Verse 17. And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. Now, you know, just to recap the story, I wanted to remind you that what happened was that Israel had originally lost the Ark of the Covenant some 20 years prior. And so the presence of God had not been with Israel all of this time. And so now as we fast forward to this part of the story, what we see is that the presence of God has returned unto the place that David has prepared for it. And specifically, we said that the name of this place is Peace. In reality, what I titled my message this morning was No Justice, No Peace. And the reason that I titled it that was the day before those policemen got shot, I was praying in my car and I was driving down the road. And I said, Lord, give me a word for your people. They're your people and you love them. And I know that you have a word to speak to them and to me. And all of a sudden, I just heard one word, peace. And so I knew I had a lot of work to do, right? Because I got to figure out exactly where the Lord wants to go. But I knew already that the Lord wanted me in some way, shape, or form to speak on peace. And then, you know, like he always does, usually he'll confirm things. And so I'm sitting there watching Fox News the next night. And as I'm watching Fox News, they're talking about, you know, these different killings that have taken place, right? The one in Baton Rouge, the one in this other killing in Minnesota, and they're protesting all over the nation. I don't know if y'all knew that or not, but I mean, there was a protest going on in New York City. There was a protest going on in Dallas. I didn't know about the one in Dallas. They weren't really talking about that one. They were talking about the one in New York City. And so they have the television on the crowd in Times Square in New York City, and the people are chanting, No justice, no peace. And when they said that, I'm thinking, the Lord wanted me to preach on peace. These people are looking for a certain type of peace, and they're looking for a certain type of justice. And they're crying out for it, but they don't really know exactly what they're crying out for. And then all of a sudden, and they, you know, they talk, oh, it's a peaceful demonstration, and they're crying out that they want peace. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, they pan to Dallas, flash news alert, policemen have been shot, and they had this sniper, and once again, it was a peaceful demonstration, and they were just trying to voice whatever the case, and all of a sudden, this sniper comes out of nowhere, and he shoots, ends up being, I think it was like kills five policemen and shoots seven other ones, all right? And so in the midst of all of that, I knew that, you know, God wanted, once again, to speak something about peace. But what I want you to see is that the world is looking for a certain type of peace, and it's altogether different than the peace that God offers. Amen. As a matter of fact, in John chapter 14, verses 26 through 27, Jesus told his disciples, he's about to go to the Father, and he tells them in this passage of Scripture, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So Jesus is letting us know, as a matter of fact, he says in another spot in John chapter 16, verse 33, he said, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world.
Amen.
In the midst of the world that we live in, and I'm telling you, as we near the end more and more, we're going to continue to see chaos. We should pray for our nation. We should pray for our leaders. We should ask the Holy Spirit to move upon the face of the earth. Because truthfully, as we get closer and closer to the end and the chaos becomes more rampant, then people are going to start looking for the real answers. Right now they're in the streets and they're crying out for peace. But once again, the type of peace that they're looking for is they're looking for the world to give them peace. Mm-hmm. They're looking for a certain type of justice. And the reality of it is that, and I listen to me, I'll be the first one to tell you that, you know, I understand that it's wrong. And it seems like the way that the media puts it anyway, that they keep on shooting black people and they keep on, or African-Americans, they keep on putting African-Americans in strangleholds. I do know that there are white folks getting killed too by police.
Yeah.
And I do know that sometimes, but at the same time, I want you to see that it seems as though to me, and maybe I'm wrong in this, that the media isn't helping anything. In reality, they're pushing all this information out there, and it's not going to lead to peace. In reality, it's going to lead to more chaos and more frustration. And they can sit here and say, give us peace, but the reality of it is this. Until the Prince of Peace shows up in people's hearts, and he was a racist yesterday, he's going to be a racist tomorrow. It's not until Jesus shows up in your heart. Listen to me. If you're still a racist today, come on, somebody, help me. And you know what? Then we need the Lord to do a work on the inside of our heart to bring peace. And so the point that I made with all of this narrative was this, was that God was bringing the presence of God back to his people. And the peace of God is something that is altogether different than what the world is crying out for when they cry out for peace. They want things to be quiet. They want a lack of violence. That's not going to happen until the Prince of Peace shows up.
Amen.
And the Spirit of Christ is now the ruling spirit that's pervasive in the land. Amen?
Amen?
But the kind of peace that God brings is because he said, I'm going away, but my Father's going to send the Comforter. The Parakletos. Para means side. Kletos means called. He's the one that's been called alongside. You ever been in the midst of a circumstance or a trial? Isn't it nice to have somebody on your side?
Yeah.
Jesus wants you to know that even though you're going through things in the midst of this world, even though you're going through things in the midst of your life, that he has sent the Comforter. That because of what he's done at the cross, now the Holy Spirit can come along your side and can bring you a peace. Amen. That you won't even begin, you won't even be able to understand it.
Amen.
Because it's a peace that Jesus gives, and it's altogether different than what the peace that the world has to offer. Now, one of the things that pointed out that really stuck out to me in verse 17 was that when they brought the ark of the Lord back and they put it in the tent that David had pitched for it, then what he did was he offered up burnt offerings and peace offerings. Did you see that? So I want you to turn with me to the book of Leviticus. We're going to go to Leviticus chapter 1. I like to teach and preach, and I hope that's okay because we need to learn the Word of God. And I want to talk to you just real quick about three of the Levitical offerings. Does anybody know how many Levitical offerings there were? Five Levitical offerings, right? And of the five, we're only really going to talk about three. There was a burnt offering. There was a meat offering. That's right. There is a sin offering. There was a peace offering. There was a trespass offering and a sin offering. Now, of these three first offerings were known as sweet, savor offerings. Basically, all these offerings were offered up on fire. Fire is a type of judgment, right? Fire is a type of judgment, and the animals, or in the meat offering, it wasn't an animal, it wasn't an animal sacrifice. It was still offered up on the fire, and the scripture says that it became a sweet savor in the nose of God. Now, the other two, the trespass offering and the sin offering, were not known as sweet savor sacrifices. And the reason why is because the trespass offering and the sin offering emphasize the sin of man. See, there was an aspect of the cross that wasn't pleasing to God the Father. That's why there was that moment in time whenever Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? There was a moment in time when Jesus didn't feel the presence of the Father. And I've had many conversations with a lot of preachers about this, but one thing that I can surely tell you about this morning is this, is that the God the Father did not turn his face away from Jesus because of Jesus' sin.
Amen.
Because Jesus had no sin.
Amen.
God the Father turned his face away from Jesus for a moment in time because of your sin.
Amen.
Because of my sin. My sin was laid upon the Savior, and because of that, God the Father turned, because fellowship was broken because of sin. God the Father turned his face for a moment in time.
Yeah.
There's an aspect of the cross that is repulsive in the eyes of God, because it represents the sin of man, and it's sin that separates man from God's presence. But there's an aspect to the cross that's a sweet savor in the nostrils of God. And why is that? Because it's all representative of Jesus, and it's all representative of his obedience and the offering of his sinlessness on the cross to pay the penalty and to remove the barrier that stands between us and the presence of God. Amen. And the burnt offering, that's the first one I want to talk to you about. If you look at Leviticus chapter 1, it says in verse 2, "Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, if any man of you bring an offering unto the Lord, you shall bring your offering of the cattle, even of the herd and of the flock. If his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the Lord, let him offer a male." He's talking about if it be a burnt offering, a specific type of offering. "Let it be a male without blemish." Now, so without the blemish means what? It describes the sinlessness of the Lord. Amen? "Without blemish, he shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. And he shall put his hand upon the head of the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him." So one of the things that we have to understand is that first off, we're talking about a burnt offering. And in this burnt offering, it's representative of that the believer had to bring the offering before the Lord, put his hand upon the animal, which signified that there was a transference that was taking place. The offerer who was bringing the animal, his sin was now transferred to this innocent animal. And this innocent animal was going to die in his place. And you and I need to understand that when we put faith in the Lord, a transference took place. The scripture said essentially what happened was that he took our sin upon him. One of the scriptures says that he who knew no sin became sin. And the reality of it is that it's not meaning that sin was in him. The idea is that he became a sin offering.
Yes.
He took your sin upon him. Then it says in Galatians 3:27, those of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus, we don't have time to get into what the word baptism really means there, but essentially you have clothed yourself with Christ, you have put him on. You and I need to understand that just as the offerer in the Old Testament laid his hand upon the animal, signifying a transference of his guilt moving to the innocent animal, and now the animal dying in his place, through faith, your guilt that you received from Adam was placed upon Jesus, and he took it with him to the cross, and he died on the cross, paying the penalty of your sin, and a transference through faith took place where he took your guilt and you got his righteousness.
Amen.
And now there can be reconciliation between you and the presence of God. Amen.
Amen.
He goes on to say, "And he shall kill the bullock before the Lord," verse 5, "and the priests, Aaron's son, shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood round about upon the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And he shall flay the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. And the sons of Aaron, the priest, shall put fire upon the altar and lay the wood in order upon the fire. And the priest, Aaron's son, shall lay the parts, the head, the fat, in order upon the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. But his inwards and his legs shall he wash in water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord." So what I wanted you to see, is even if you go down to verse 13, and once again it says again, "But he shall wash the inwards and the legs with water, and the priest shall bring it all of it, and burn it upon the altar. It is a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord." So essentially taking place is that first you got to inspect this animal. You make sure it doesn't have a blemish on the outside. Then they flay it. It means they open it up. And they cut it open. They open it up. And they start inspecting. And they're looking at the kidneys. They're looking at the liver. They're looking at all of the various internal organs, all the intestines, everything that they, and they inspect it and they wash it to where they can get a good look. If you find one blemish, one problem, you have to kick that one out and you have to go get another one. And so they're flaying it open and really washing the inside of it, washing the legs, cleaning it all up, represents again the purity of the Lord Jesus Christ. But that whole offering was offered up on the altar as a burnt, it represents Jesus in his obedience, giving his all back unto the Father with his willingness. Philippians says that let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, didn't consider it something to be grasped to, but he lowered himself, he humbled himself to become obedient as a servant, and I'm paraphrasing, even the obedience of death, even the death of a cross. Jesus, who was in form God, the second person of the Godhead, became man so that he could serve the Father, and his service was to offer himself as a sacrifice, and this burnt offering represents him perfectly. There was a second offering right here in chapter 2 of verse 1 of Leviticus. It was called a meat offering. Now, don't get confused with the word meat, because in the King James language, the word meat just meant food. You okay with that? You're going to be able to wrap your mind around that? Meat meant food. And really and truly, like a lot of people would say, this would probably have been better termed a meal offering because it was made out of flour. And the flour had to be fine flour. That's what it says right there in verse 1. When anyone will offer a meat offering unto the Lord, his offering shall be of fine flour. He shall pour oil upon it and put frankincense thereon. And he shall bring it to Aaron's sons, the priests, and he shall take thereout his handful of the flour thereof and the oil thereof. Now, what I want you to know, I'm not doing an in-depth teaching on all of this, but what I do want you to understand is this, is that the whole burnt offering represents the cross. It represents Jesus giving his all in death to the Father. The meat offering represents his life, amen? And it represents the fact that as fine flour, meaning it was pure, he had no sin in him. There was no leaven in this meat offering, at least at this point in time. No leaven, which is yeast, which represents sin. And so this portion of the offering represents Christ in his life and the fact that he was sinless. Some people have even talked about the fact that frankincense is bitter, and the frankincense was placed on here describing the bitterness of the life that he had to live as he offered himself in sacrifice for us. See, once again, this is the message that we preach. Paul said we preach Christ crucified. It's not just Jesus, the good teacher. It's not just Jesus, the great healer. No, God's redemption plan required the Christ, the anointed one, the promised one that the prophets foretold for thousands of years as the prophets of Israel spoke, and he manifest in the flesh. His name was Jesus. That's what the word Christ means, anointed one, but his name was Jesus. Amen? Amen. And not just him, who he was, but also what he did. And so once again, we see the message of Jesus Christ and him crucified. Messiah, the fine flour, amen, the sacrifice, the whole burnt offering. Now what I need you to know is that David, when the presence of God came back to the city of peace, because we're talking about peace this morning, I'm telling you that Jesus brings a peace that the world can't bring. Jesus gives a peace that the world can't give, amen? And whenever the presence of God came back to Jerusalem, David offered up burnt offerings and he offered up peace offerings. Now, anytime a burnt offering was offered, the meat offering or the meal offering was always offered with it. Jesus Christ and him crucified. And until those offerings were offered, or at least also a sin or a trespass offering, the peace offering could not be offered up. See, the peace offering represents communion. It represents relationship restored back to God. Whenever you have your relationship restored back to God, You have peace with God.
Yes.
There's a scripture out of Colossians that says he's made peace through the blood of his cross. Amen?
Yeah.
So whenever you go to chapter 3 of Leviticus, just the first verse, and then we're going to go to 7, because I want to just kind of read a little bit to you out of chapter 7. It says, and if in chapter 3, verse 1, and if his oblation, which is another word for gift, be a sacrifice of peace offering, if he offer it of the herd, whether it be male or female, he shall offer it without blemish before the Lord. Go into chapter 7. Verse 11. It says, and this is the law of the sacrifice of peace offerings, which he shall offer unto the Lord. And of it he shall offer one out of the whole oblation for a heave offering unto the Lord. Now, let me just stop for a second. When it says one, if you read the whole thing about the peace offering, there's either a breast offered up or a right shoulder. And it's heaved, it's waved before the Lord. But then it's turned around and it's given to the priest, okay? And I'll explain that in a second. As a heave offering unto the Lord, and it shall be the priest that sprinkles the blood of the peace offering. So the priest that presides over this peace offering receives this gift of the peace, a portion of this animal, whether it be the breast or the right shoulder, and it's given to the priest that presides over this offering. All right, verse 15. And the flesh of the sacrifice of his peace offerings for thanksgiving shall be eaten the same day that it is offered. He shall not leave any of it until the morning. Now, it might be a little bit confusing to be able to read between the lines there, but the way that the peace offering worked was that either the right shoulder or a piece of the breast was given to the priest that presided over it. It was offered as a heave offering unto the Lord, but then the priest was able to take it and to eat that portion of the animal. In verse 15, though, it's talking about the rest of the animal, and it's to be eaten by the offerer that brought the animal. So you understand what I'm saying? The priest gets a portion of the animal, and the offerer is able actually to partake of this offering. This is the only one that the offerer was able to partake of. And once again, it represents communion. Amen. A common union. And they're partaking together in this. But I want you to go now to verse 30, because I want you to see that the Lord gets a portion also. Verse 30. His own hands, talking about the offerer, shall bring the offerings of the Lord made by fire, the fat with the breast. It shall he bring, that the breast may be waved for a wave offering before the Lord. And the priest shall burn the fat upon the altar, but the breast shall be Aaron's and his sons. So with the peace offering, once again, a portion goes to the priest. The fat is burned on the altar to the Lord, and the offerer gets the rest of the animal, and they all partake of that animal. And it represents communion has been restored between God and the offerer. Amen. And but in order for that to happen, there had to be a whole burnt offering that took place first and a meal offering that took place, which represented Jesus Christ and him crucified in the Old Testament. Amen. And what you and I need to understand is that peace is brought to us.
Yes.
Through our faith in Christ and what he did for us at the cross, and our relationship with God being restored. You know, I've told the people in the church many times, in case we have some guests that maybe haven't been around, the God that I serve, I'm convinced he's a literary genius.
Yes.
He wrote this book and he knew what he was writing long before I ever wrote it. Listen to me, if you can school, or whenever you go to Nichols or whatever school you go to, and they tell you, I want you to brainstorm and I want you to come up with some ideas to write about. You think that the God, he had this thing worked out from the beginning to the end. The Word of God says in 1 Peter 1:18, you were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold from your vain traditions that you received from your fathers, but instead by the precious blood of a lamb, which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. Before God ever formed the earth, before he ever planted Adam in the midst of the garden, he already knew that Adam was going to go the way of the liar, and that sin was going to come unto humanity, and that the entirety of the human race was going to be bound or infected with sin, if you would permit me. But yet, nevertheless, he had a plan. Yes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Why would he do such a thing? Because God doesn't want a bunch of robots.
Amen. Amen.
God wants people who have a free will that will turn around and reciprocate love to Him.
Yes.
God is love, and He wants to pour His love upon you. Sometimes you wake up in the mirror and you look at yourself. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Not saying physically, that's not what I'm getting at. You look at yourself, you look at your life, you look at where you are, you look at the decisions that you've made, the wrong turns that you've taken, and you question, why would God love me?
Right.
You don't question it? Well, sometimes I wonder.
Yeah.
Why would God love me?
Yeah.
After all the wrong that I've done, after the way that I've treated people, after the things that I've said, and the way that I've hurt others, why would God, I don't know why God would want to love me, but nevertheless, He does want to love me.
Yes.
And He went out of His way to prove His love to me.
Yes.
He sent His only begotten Son, the darling of heaven, the one that never messed up one time, the one that obeyed the Father in everything that He was ever called to do, said all the right things, thought all the right thoughts, did all the right actions, never once failed in one area, and then offered in obedience His life to restore you, to restore me. Into the presence of God.
Amen.
Oh, what a beautiful plan.
Yes.
And that's waiting for us. God wants to restore peace into the midst of our lives. Amen. Praise God. So the first thing that I wanted to really say, I'm really, I guess in a way, kind of starting my conclusion, is that true peace is restoration with God. I mean, the people can scream all they want to, no justice, no peace. And they're looking, they want less violence. And even I hate to say it, but you know, I think something's up myself, but
I do too.
You know, this old boy shows up with another assault rifle. Assault rifle in Orlando, assault rifle here. Did you see what happened? I don't mean to get political on you, but did you see what happened after the Orlando gay club incident the next day? Did you notice? Probably hadn't been watching the news. That's probably a good thing. The next day, the Democrats sat down in the House and they said, we're not budging until you give us gun law legislation.
Yeah, I see that.
We want to start messing and tinkering with the Second Amendment. I don't know what you think about the Second Amendment, but I'm telling you right now, why in the world, the next day after that, is the first thing they want to do is take people's guns away? I don't understand. I think I do, but I don't want to get into all that too much. What I'm trying to get at, though, is that not only do you have that, but then you have this other situation. I'm telling you, something is going on in the midst of this land, and it's not going to get any better. Peace is not that people that you're going to see no more violence in the land. No, because that's not going to happen until Jesus comes back. True peace that our heart is craving is restoration with God and a relationship with God, to be in right standing with God. Amen? And God wrote a prescription. Praise God.
Mm-hmm.
Second thing that I want you to know is that God offers, well, really and truly, let's go to Romans right there. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. We're talking about restoration with God. And I want you to see, after we've looked at all these Old Testament passages, how you can see in the book of Romans, where Paul says this, how this is really connecting perfectly to these Levitical sacrifices. Now, if you and I don't understand the Old Testament, it's hard for us to read it in the New. But once we understand some things about the Old Testament, we can see it more clearly in the New Testament. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Now, some of you have been with us for a while, and I mean, if I put this up here, you probably could give us an answer, but what does the word justified mean to you? I mean, what have you, is anybody willing to just throw something out there for me real quick?
Something legally innocent.
Yes, it's a, amen, legally innocent. It's a declaration. God spoke. God said, innocent, justified, no longer guilty, amen? And what did he speak that on? Well, if you went back into the previous portion of Romans, what you would realize is that man was guilty. God pronounced all men guilty, whether they be Gentile, whether they be Jew, they were all guilty. But God gave us Jesus, who was righteousness. And He went through the whole scenario And it's really talking about the fact that Jesus shed his blood. And so now Paul's saying, therefore, being justified, being declared legally innocent by God. Now you need to understand that. See, this is God's word. I was a Christian for 12 years, didn't even know what it meant to be justified by faith. Now that's a crying shame right there. I'm just telling you right now, if that's the first time you ever heard the definition of that, it's okay. Don't freak out because you're not the only one. But I'm here to tell you right now, that's a problem, Houston. That we're going to sit here and be Christians for that long and not even know what it means to be justified. See, the word of God says that God has a plan, and this is the way it works. I'm going to send my son, he's going to die, and when you take your faith and put it in that, a transference takes place. I'm going to clothe you with his righteousness. Now when I look at you, I no longer see your guilt and your failure. Instead, I see his obedience and his righteousness. And I say, you are innocent. You are cleared of all charges. You are no longer guilty because you have accepted the sacrifice of my son. And when you and I begin to be able to believe that by faith, the Holy Spirit begins to do something by the power of his Holy Spirit. It begins to reveal it to us in our heart. And the next thing you know, peace start showing up. It says right there, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. We've been made now in right standing with God.
Yes.
The whole burnt offering, the meat offering, peace offerings. Faith in him and what he did now brings peace between you and God. But not only that, we also have access by faith into grace.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Grace isn't just forgiveness.
Yes.
Say, I used to think that that's all it was. I used to think that grace was just God's unmerited favor. And it is that. You can't earn it. But grace is power from God. The definition of grace in the Greek dictionary is that it's a divine influence on the heart.
Yes.
And its reflection in the life.
Amen.
Grace is an inside job. God takes grace and he does something in your heart.
Yes.
That you can't do. You can't read enough. You can't go to church enough. You can't speak in tongues enough. You can't go to enough church services in a week. You can't tell enough people about Jesus in order for you to change the inside of your heart. Grace is a gift from God,
Amen.
A work by the Holy Ghost who does something on the inside of your
Amen.
Heart and is
yes.
done based off of faith in God's plan of what yes. he offered. And when you put your faith in that and keep your faith in that, the Holy Spirit goes to work in your life and he starts
yes.
changing things that your
yes.
counselor ain't
yes.
going to change.
Amen.
Ain't no, I'm sorry, ain't no pill going to change. It's going to be the Holy Spirit
Amen.
Doing
yes.
his work
Amen.
On the inside
Amen.
Of your life. And that's the only thing.
Yes.
That's
going to
change. Amen.
Amen.
So true peace is restoration with God.
Yes.
And when you have restoration with God, the Holy Spirit is doing work
yes.
on the inside of your life. Amen.
Amen.
Next thing I want you to know is this, is that God also offers peace in the midst of a trial. Amen. It says right here in Philippians chapter 4. So I don't know what you're going through today. Some of you going through more than others, but we're all going through something.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
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 Some of us are going through more than others,
yes.
but we're all going through something.
Yes.
Amen. Because we live on a fallen earth.
Yes.
And the good news I have for you is this, is that no matter what you're going through,
mm-hmm.
and still, as much as you could take the five people in here that are going through the most and put them together, and they probably still hadn't gone as much through what the Apostle Paul went through.
Yes.
As he sat in that old dingy, nasty prison, the Mamertine prison. Yeah, y'all ever heard of that place? It's a big old pit. It was dug as a pit in Rome, and it was all damp at the bottom of this thing. He wrote it in 2 Timothy, and he told Timothy, he said, bring the scrolls and the cloak.
Mm-hmm.
It's cold. Try to make it here before winter comes. I need you to bring that cloak. I need something to lay on. I need something to cover. But in prayer, he wanted the scrolls. I need the scrolls. I need the Old Testament scriptures. You know? And he's still worried about the things of God, even in the midst of that trial. He said, I've run the race. I fought the good fight.
Yes. Amen.
Now there's a crown of glory laid hold.
Yes.
Lord, help us. Help us as we get caught up in the midst of this daily life, and the enemy tries to steal our joy, and he tries to come between us and the God that loved us enough to send his son Jesus, that we would be reminded that this is just a dress rehearsal for eternity. Amen. Help us, Lord. But it says in Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7, it says, be careful for nothing. Now, you got to be careful. This is King James Version. I thought it said, don't be careful. It says, be careful for nothing. Why are you telling us to be careful? Well, because number one, you know, some people say, well, I don't need to wear my seatbelt because the Bible says, be careful for nothing. That's not what it's talking about. It's okay to take care. It's okay to be precautious and to walk with wisdom.
Yes.
You ever seen somebody that got in a bad head on with, you know, it can get ugly.
Yeah.
All right. It means anxious. Don't be anxious. That's what the word careful there in the Greek means. It means don't be anxious for anything. And how do I stop myself from being anxious, preacher? Well, you're going to need the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
To move in the midst of your life.
Yeah.
Some people are overwhelmed by anxiety. They're overwhelmed by anxiousness. And they find themselves in a situation where they don't know where they're going to get the answer that they're craving and that they're looking for. The scripture says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding.
Yes.
Shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So God has a deal that he's wanting to work with us. First, the part of the deal is that I sent my son Jesus to die for you on the cross. You put your faith in that. Your relationship with me now has been restored, and peace has been brought into the midst of your life. But I got good news for you, because even though you're walking through the trials of life, I want to encourage you with my word. Don't be anxious for anything as you go through it. Instead, what I'm asking you to do is to seek my face through prayer and supplication. And what I'm telling you I will do, I'm telling you according to my word, what I'm going to do is I am going to give you the peace of God which surpasses all understanding.
Amen.
It means it doesn't even make any sense.
Yeah.
When you look at it from the logical perspective, the situation hasn't changed. Nothing's different today than what it was yesterday. But all of a sudden, you feel something different because the presence of God now, hallelujah, has entered into the midst of the situation, and it surpasses understanding. God has showed up, and he brought peace.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Well, this is what I want to do. I want to close with Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. Because I want you to know that we also need peace in our relationship, and we need peace and the decisions that we make in life. Amen?
Amen.
It says in Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, put on therefore. Now, I did not look. I got to be honest with you. I mean, if Sean has the app and he can do it, that's cool. I did not look up put on therefore. But I would imagine it's in the middle voice of the Greek. And what that means is that something has already been accomplished. In other words, God did his part, but then the action of the verb, there's also something you're doing. And so now that you understand what God has done, you have to be willing to clothe yourself with the things of God. Amen? And so when it says, put on therefore as the elect of God, that means the chosen out ones, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy. In other words, you need to come to the realization if you like got this bad attitude, and you're like, well, you know, that old boy, he shouldn't have had a gun in it on his side anyway. Whenever, like, listen to me, we don't know the whole story. I'm just using that as an example. You don't know the whole story about everybody's life. You don't know what they're going through.
Amen.
But instead of us, when you hear yourself spouting out hatred, and you hear yourself spouting out all kind of aggravation, and you find yourself walking in the flesh and say, the scripture says, put on bowels of mercy. It means bowels, your innards. On the inside of who you are, be merciful. Jesus was merciful. Amen?
Amen.
It doesn't mean that everybody's doing everything right.
Amen.
But if you find yourself all frustrated and aggravated, no, that's not right either. Put on bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Long-suffering means patience in relationships. He's like, you know some people that get on your nerves?
Mm-hmm.
You know how you act whenever they get on your nerves? Mm-hmm. You holler and scream at them? Okay. No. Forbearing one another. Having patience and enduring. Forgiving one another. See, that sounds like peace.
Yes.
In the midst of a relationship. But you know what I can tell you? It's also connected to the fruit of the Spirit.
Yes.
And you will not muster up the strength that you need in order to be long-suffering with somebody that's getting on your nerves. You will not produce that in you because it's not a fruit of Josh and it's not a fruit of Matt. It's a fruit of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And it has to be produced by the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives.
Amen.
And He works based on our faith in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
If any man have a quarrel with against any, even as Christ forgave you, you need to forgive also. Amen?
Amen.
And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. Of perfectness. That means love, the word charity there. But this is where I really want you to see. And we'll close with this. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. The word rule there in the Greek is brabeo, and it actually literally means to be an umpire or to make a decision. You know, back in the days, they had the gladiators and all these games, the Greek games way back then. And this is the word that the Holy Spirit told Paul to use, and it's descriptive of an umpire or referee, someone that makes decisions. And so one of the things that I think that the Lord has showed me through experience and through this word right here is that sometimes there's decisions that I have to make in my life. This is probably one of the most important practical points to this whole message, so you might want to bear with me just for about 2 more minutes. You know, whenever we go through life, sometimes we make decisions. Well, there's a lot of decisions to make.
Yeah.
And hopefully we're praying about those decisions.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Where I'm going to go to school whenever I'm a little younger. What I'm going to go to school for. You don't want to just go to school to be a doctor because your daddy told you to be a doctor.
Amen.
Because that might not be God's will for your life. Amen?
Amen.
Now that I have my job, what job am I going to take? I need to pray about that. Okay? So hopefully we're doing that part of it and we're praying. Amen? Or a new decision. Should I buy this house? Should I buy this vehicle? Hopefully we're praying about that. I can't tell you that I've always done it the way that I'm supposed to. I'm admitting to you that I haven't. But we're supposed to pray about those things. Okay, preacher, I got that part of it. I've been praying. I prayed about the vehicle. I prayed about the house. But I can't say that I really got an answer. But you know, and I bought it, and now everything's a mess. The point that I'm trying to make is that God is providing peace. Amen.
Yes.
And it's not like the peace that the world gives. It's the peace that God gives. And it starts off with restoration into God's presence. But even in the midst of a trial and a situation, and you don't know how you're going to get out of this deal, God wants to send His peace. It surpasses understanding. Amen?
Amen.
And also, I want you to know that God will help you with the decisions that you make.